Well, good morning.
Good morning.
That's pretty good, being this the week after VBS, I tell you.
Hammer, saw.
I know, all this stuff. Yeah, this room looks a lot different than it did just a few days ago. But I want to thank all of you. You know, many of you are on campus all week or on campus Friday night, or you were praying for us. It was a great week of Vacation Bible School. And I pray that we'll continue to see the fruit come from that. I do want to share a few quick announcements with you as we prepare for worship today and just prepare for a week of ministry, especially in response to Vacation Bible School. This Wednesday night, we are having our first Super Summer for the kiddos at 6 o'clock. The youth will also be meeting as well. This Wednesday night is game night, so we encourage all our kids to come out, invite friends and all those things. We'll be promoting it with all the different families that we had an opportunity to connect with over Vacation Bible School, so we're excited about that. Also on Tuesday and Thursday, we'll resume our regularly scheduled, there you go, TNT, our community outreach. On Tuesday, we'll be at Pine Ridge. On Thursday, we'll be off Hood Road. So I realize for many of you, we're working during the day. You're not able to be a part of that, but you're sending your teenagers and dropping off your kiddos, and that's greatly appreciated. That's helped a great deal. But that's at 11:15 on Tuesday and Thursday. Tonight, we'll be resuming our Bible study, Mini Gifts, One Spirit, focusing on spiritual gifts here at 6 o'clock. So we encourage you to come back, be in this room, and we'll have that Bible study together. So we look forward to that as well. Choir practice tonight, except we're getting back after it. That's it. And this little microphone is driving me crazy. It's like, you know that gnat that flies around your face? Yeah, that's happening right now. But it's an expensive gnat, so I won't slap it hard. But I'll work with it over here in a minute. Also, right after the service today, if some of our deacons, if our deacons that are here, if you'll stick around, there's a couple of matters of business we need to discuss. So right after our service today, deacons, stick around. So the Lord has great things in store for us, as we've already seen throughout this week, and He's led us up to this point. So let's join our hearts in prayer this morning. Father, we thank You so much for Your kindness towards us. We thank You for Your grace. Lord, we thank You for Your mercy. We thank You for, God, just allowing us to be a part of Your kingdom work. As this past week is such a blessing to see so many folks on our campus, so many new faces or faces that we're familiar with that have been gone for so long that have come back. And Lord, we just look forward to seeing what's next. Look forward to seeing how You will bless the days ahead as far as ministry to those new contacts, ministry to us, as we took steps of obedience that You moved in our heart to take over this last week or so. So I pray as we come into this summer full force, looking forward to connecting with our community, growing together as brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord, that Your Spirit will just knit our hearts together around Your vision for Echota, Your vision for this community. We pray it begins today, Lord, as we sing Your praises, Lord, as we study Your word, as we fellowship, Lord, that today will be the day that You set us aside and make us ready for what's next. We thank You for all that You've done and all You will do. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please, brother.
And good morning. Let's stand together. Hymn number 10, How Great Thou Art.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died, to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's been quite a week, and I want to expound on it just a little bit here and there. But before I do, I want to bring a couple of words to your attention. This all ties in. One of them is named is reputation, and the other is word of mouth. Now, this is my own thinking. I didn't get this out of the dictionary. But I think your reputation starts when you're born. Oh, what a lovely child. He eats anything I give it. Oh, what a terrible child. He spits out everything I give it. And as you grow older, your reputation begins to increase. You're a kid in grammar school. You're a kid in high school. You're a kid out of high school. You're a kid in college. You're building your reputation all the way. You're building your work ethic. You're building your dependability at home, at school, and now at work. And everywhere you go, you're building your reputation. And with that reputation comes word of mouth. Because people are going to talk. They're going to say something about you. Will it be good? Will it be bad? Will it be, that's a good person. I knew them back in school. You could depend on them totally. What they said was good as gold. Or, don't hire that person. That won't work. Every time the boss turns his back, they sit down and wait for him to get inside again before he starts doing work again. That's the way it goes. Now, Moses... I'm going to be in chapter 31 here just a second. Moses went up on Mount Ararat, stayed there for 40 days. And while he was there, God told him, I want you to build a tabernacle, a tent of meetings, and I want you to do a lot of things to get it ready. He dedicated a good 5 chapters of the Bible telling him what he wanted built, how he wanted it built, and what he wanted it built out of, and all the minute details that was involved in getting this put together. I don't know how Moses remembered all this, but he did. And he said, here comes the word of mouth. And God told Moses, he said, chapter 31, verse 1. Then the Lord said to Moses, see, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Ur, from the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with skills and ability in knowledge in all kinds of craft, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, bronze, to cut set stones, to work in wood, and to engrave in all kinds of craftsmanship. Moreover, I have appointed Oblak, son of Aksumashiah, the tribe of Dan, to help him. Also, I have given skills to all the craftsmen to make everything I have commanded you, the tent of meetings, the Ark of the Testament, with the atonement covers on it, and all the furnishings of the tent, the table and its articles, and the pure gold lampstands, and all its accessories, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offerings, and all the utensils, the basins with its stand, and also the woven garments, both of the sacred garments for Aaron the priest, and the garments of his sons, that they serve as priests, and anointing oil, the fragrant incense of the holy place, for the holy place, they are to be made just as I have commanded you. So then comes Vacation Bible School. Wow. We will furnish help. We need help. I can say I know a man. I know a woman. And they come. We could have used more, but they worked diligently. I saw people Friday night. Their eyes told me, I've done about all I can do. I need to sit down. I'm glad this is over. But I think some of them was here Saturday. I know they were. They stayed very late Friday night. So God provided. God helped and provided for our Chota Baptist Church. Most of you were here. There was enough small children to go nearly from that wall to that wall. God bless those teachers. They needed every moment of power that they had inside them to take care of that. So thank you. So if you will, join me in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you for a Chota Baptist Church, for the efforts that are put forth to keep this church where it's at and the way it's going. I pray, Father, for each and every one that has participated. I pray, Father, for our leaders of Vacation Bible School. Help them all, Father. Be with us as we strive to serve you, to do the will, to do the things that we can. Help us all, Father, to look to you for leadership and for guidance. In Jesus' name I do humbly pray. Amen.
All right, let's stand again. 227.
Praise him, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternity. eternal salvation. Hail him, hail him, Jesus the crucified. Sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep, and strong. Praise him, praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown him, crown him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise him, praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, praise him, ever in joyful song.
All right, you may be seated, and it's time now for our children to come forward.
The Apostle Paul told people the good news about Jesus wherever he went. When he returned to Jerusalem, the believers were glad to see him. But many Jews did not like that Paul taught people they don't have to follow Jewish laws to be saved. So these Jews made a plan to stop Paul. Paul was at the temple when a crowd of people dragged him away and tried to kill him. But a Roman official came and stopped them. The official arrested Paul and brought him to the Sanhedrin, a powerful group of Jewish priests and other leaders. Their job was to decide if a person had broken a Jewish law, and if so, to decide how that person should be punished. Paul stood in front of the Sanhedrin and looked the men in the eyes. "Friends," he said, "I have done what God wants me to do. I do not believe I have done anything wrong." Paul explained that he had been arrested because he taught that Jesus' resurrection gave hope that we all can be resurrected. The men in the Sanhedrin began arguing. Some of them thought dead people would be resurrected at the end of time, and others thought that would not happen. The Roman soldiers took Paul away to keep him safe. The next night, the Lord stood by Paul and gave him an incredible message. "Have courage," he said. "You told about me in Jerusalem. I want you to tell about me in Rome too." In the morning, a group of Jews got together and made a plan to kill Paul. They promised to not eat or drink until Paul was dead. These men told the Jewish leaders about their plan. Paul's nephew overheard this evil plan. He hurried to tell Paul what was going on. Paul told his nephew to report it to the commander. The army commander said, "Don't tell anyone that you told me about this plan." Then the commander told two of his officers to get together a large group of soldiers and horses. They brought a horse for Paul to ride on. And that night, the soldiers took Paul to Caesarea to see the governor. Even when others threatened his life, Paul continued to obey Jesus. He believed that God, who showed his love for the world by sending his son to die on the cross and rise again, would help him through hard times. We too can risk everything to share the gospel with courage because we know that God loves us and will care for us.
You know, it's worth it when we work for God, right?
No, that's not even courageous.
To be courageous, that's a good word. And I thought about that too, because, you know, Paul knew he was going to get beat up, and he got beat up, and he got thrown in jail, but what did he keep doing? She kept thinking about Jesus, didn't she? And then when he was asleep that night, Jesus came to him, or God told him in his dream, he woke him up and said, hey, keep doing what you do, because why? I am with you. And that's the same thing that God tells us today. God is always with us. He wants us to be courageous and tell people about him. Sometimes it's not easy, is it? Sometimes we may get scared. Sometimes we may want to talk to somebody like, boy, I'm kind of scared to talk to that person or tell them about God. But God tells us he's always with us. He'll always be with us, okay? And in the end, it's always worth it. Okay? Let's go next door. We'll learn a little bit more, okay? So thank y'all guys for coming. We'll go right out that door, okay? Let me pray for us first, okay? Sorry, we got that. Dear God, we thank you. We first of all thank you for your son, Jesus, that you sent to die on the cross for our sins. We thank you, God, that you can give us courage to do the things that sometimes may be hard. But we know that you're with us no matter what, because you tell us that you are. Lord, help us to tell others about you and what you have done for us. These things we ask. Amen. Amen. Okay. Thank you, guys. Go right there.
Let's all stand for our offertory hymn. It's number 3 in the hymnal, Worthy of Worship.
Worthy of worship, worthy of praise, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all the glad songs we can sing, worthy of all of the offerings we bring. You are worthy, Father, Creator. You are worthy, Savior, Sustainer. You are worthy, worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise. Worthy of reverence, worthy of fear, worthy of love and devotion, worthy of bowing and bending of knees, worthy of all this and added to these. You are worthy, Father, Creator. You are worthy, Savior, Sustainer. You are worthy, worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise. Almighty Father, Master and Lord, King of all kings and Redeemer, Wonderful Counselor, Comforter, Friend, Savior and Source of our life without end. You are worthy, Father, Creator. You are worthy, Savior, Sustainer. You are worthy, worthy and wonderful, worthy of worship and praise.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for another opportunity to be in your house to fellowship together and to worship you. We want to thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. We ask, Lord, that you bless this offering this morning to the furtherance of your kingdom. We ask you just be with all those who are traveling, those who are sick, bring them back to us safely, Lord. We ask all these things in Jesus' precious name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Well, this morning I invite you to turn back to the book of Hebrews. I knew we took a little detour last week as we focused on Vacation Bible School. But we're going back to the book of Hebrews. We're going all the way back to the beginning of the book of Hebrews. I know for a couple of months there, we were in Hebrews 11 and working through the Hall of Faith. And as you may have remembered, I said, you know, don't worry, we're going to get the whole book. So that's where the journey begins today. Hebrews chapter 1. Starting in chapter 1 there. Just a little bit of background about the book of Hebrews and our study that we're about to embark on together. I've entitled this study, Greater Than. Because as you'll see, as we work through the book of Hebrews, and I'm sure you've already come to the conclusion of, as we've worked through the book of, through Hebrews 11, that Christ is greater than all things. As we talked about different Old Testament saints doing things by faith, by the work of Christ within them, you know, even those that have not yet realized the promise or seen the promise with their eyes or touched the hands of Jesus, they still had faith in what God would accomplish. So as we work through the book of Hebrews over the next little bit or through the summer, we'll be focusing on the supremacy or the superiority of Christ. Now, a couple of things to note before we dive into the book of Hebrews full force. Hebrews is known as what we call a general letter. You know, in the New Testament, you know, we have 27 books, and we're all familiar with the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then Acts, a history book. Then, of course, we all love to talk about Revelation, try to figure it all out. You know, thankfully, the Lord keeps that veiled for us. But those books in the middle there of between Revelation and Acts are called letters or epistles. And we have Pauline letters, letters that are attributed to Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament. And then we have general letters. We're not 100% sure on authorship of all of them, but some of them we do know, you know, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and such. Hebrews is one of those where we're not real sure who wrote it. But we do know that it is authoritative. We do know it's part of the Scripture. So therefore, it has impact, has meaning for our life. As we think about the writing of the book of Hebrews, many have attributed to Paul because he wrote most of the New Testament. Why not the book of Hebrews too? But as we begin to look at it just a little bit underneath the surface, we see that the Greek that's used there is different. It's a little higher end Greek, if you will. All right, it's like you know, someone that's a medical doctor talking about a medical procedure, and then me trying to explain a procedure to you, okay? That kind of difference in language, all right? So that's what we see there. So it points away from Paul, maybe points to other people like Peter or maybe even Barnabas or others. We're not sure, but we do know that it is inspired. It comes from the very mouth of God, and that's why it's here for his people, for his church. So that's where our journey begins in the book of Hebrews today as we look at Hebrews chapter 1. Talking about the greatest revelation, and that being Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 1, starting in verse 1, says this, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making a purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your truth. We thank you for your revealed promises throughout the ages and even to us today. We pray now as we reflect on Lord, your word, Lord, that we may gain understanding of who Christ is, Lord, not only for just the knowledge, but Lord, also for our lives. Lord, as we read and as we listen, as we reflect on what your Spirit has to say today, Lord, may we be eternally changed because of the truth of Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, this morning, as we look at this passage, we're going to really see it in two different ways or two different aspects of it as they unfold. First, we're going to see, fulfillment of the truth, how Christ himself is the fulfillment of the truth. And we'll see that seen in verse 1 and in verse 2. And then we'll see the incarnation of the truth, how that truth, who is Christ, comes and lives among us and what roles he plays, as you remember or gleaned from reading just a few moments ago.
But I want us to understand before we dive into our outline and kind of work through this passage, the real focus here is that history begins and ends with Jesus Christ. I think it's so important that we understand that. The creation, as we saw here, and as you know from the fullness of Scripture, or maybe that's something you're discovering now, creation begins with Him, and the consummation or the fulfillment of all things ends with Him, or is complete with Him. Now we say, well, that's right, yeah, that's good, theological talk, but can I tell you this too? Your story, your personal history begins and ends with Jesus. And as we look at Scripture, we see that this is God's story, God's revelation to people, and how God is telling us, you need me. Century after century, year after year, month after month, day after day, moment by moment, He is helping us to see the answer that all of us desire, the answer, the hope that all of us need, rests in Jesus. So we work through this passage. It'll be very easy to kind of slip into, oh, these are great theological observations and on, because it is important for us to have right theology, okay? And I pray that the last 2+ years that the Lord has allowed me to serve as your pastor, that you've understood that. And some of you are like, maybe a little too much theology. But the reality of it is, you need to have right theology to have right action, to have a right response. So we need to know really who Jesus is and what He calls us to do as His people. So this morning, I pray as we work through this theological text, as we talk about who Jesus is, that indeed you see how His importance, His significance impacts your life, where you were, where you are, and where you will be. So let's look together. We'll start with the fulfillment of truth. Starting in verse 1, back to verse 1. It says, right out of the gate, long ago, God chose to reveal Himself to man. God chose to reveal Himself to humanity, to speak to us. You know, interesting here. Long ago, at many times and in many ways. God's used a variety of ways to get our attention from the garden moving forward. And we see that, as we see in this very first verse, He spoke to our fathers, spoke to our spiritual forefathers through the prophets. Now, when we think about that, we think of the Old Testament. You know, many of us in this room have spent a considerable amount of time in the Old Testament. You know, as we work through VBS, there are some Old Testament references there. Yeah, we lean pretty heavy into the New Testament and the works of Christ and Him calling His disciples and what it means to be a follower of Christ. But the Old Testament is what sets the stage for that. Now, I want you to think just for a moment that God chose, as the Word says there, and as we see in Scripture, God chose to speak to man. That's an act of grace. We understand from Scripture, humanity has alienated itself from God. Because of sin that we have allowed to come into our life, we make ourselves enemies of God. God creates us, gives us purpose, but because of our poor decisions, because of our own sinfulness, our corruption, we set ourselves aside from that. We run away from that. We alienate ourselves. But God, from the very beginning, has chosen to go after the rebellious children. He has chosen to go after those that sinned against Him in the garden, that generation after generation have chosen to rebel against Him. We see here, long ago, at many times and many ways, God spoke. God chose to reveal Himself to His people. Didn't have to do that. He could have said, man, humanity is a mess. I'm just going to let it run its course and fall apart. And we actually, as we look through Scripture, we see there's moments. Remember the flood. Remember other things like that where He does have to set the course right and do some purification work. But He never gives up on humanity. He never gives up on man. He continues to reveal Himself to them. And we see that He does that throughout the ages in many ways, many other ways. You get a little tongue-tied as you look at this passage in many times and many ways. You know, one of the things that we talk about in some of the survey classes that I teach at Shorter, and I know we've talked about it here before, as we began to talk about Revelation, how God shows himself or reveals himself to people, we really see there's two kinds. And I know we've said this before. There's what we call a general revelation, a revelation that everybody has, okay? You know, whether they're a follower of Christ or not. And we see that in nature. You know, everybody can walk outside and see how beautiful creation is. And it points to the fact there's something beyond us. There's something greater. Reality of it, too. And granted, it may differ in different cultures or maybe within our own upbringing. But as we think about our own moral compass, we all have a moral compass, a moral consciousness. And the fact that we have that, and sometimes it doesn't stay, keep us in check as it needs to, but the fact that it's there, we know the difference between right and wrong. That begins with this great lawgiver that instilled that in us. And also we look at history and we see the fingerprint of God. These general revelation, these general ways, these common graces that God shows humanity. But then there's a second type of revelation, a second way that God speaks to humanity. And he does that through what we call special revelation, miracles, where God interrupts human history. He interrupts, if you will, the natural order of the natural order of things, and reveals himself, does something miraculous to draw people to him, himself. We see that through divine visitations. We see that in Scripture where God shows up, whether it's an angelic presence or manifests in such a way that grabs people's attention and points them to himself, that helps them to see the fullness of his glory. And we see that also through Scripture. God's written revelation, calling people to himself. Many times and in many ways, God has spoken to people. And as we see in verse 1, he has done that throughout the prophets. Because as we work through the book of Hebrews, you'll see that this is written to a Jewish audience. This is written to Jews, Hebrews of the time, helping them to understand that Jesus has come to fulfill all of the Old Testament, to bring them to the realization that he is the fulfillment of truth. So as we look at this and understand that the Old Testament is pointing its way to Jesus, we see that the Old Testament provides promises that await fulfillment. Many of us have spent some time as we work through seven statements of Jesus. You may remember that from, I guess it was Easter or so ago, as we worked through that season together, as we've talked about at Christmas, the Advent, and the anticipation of the Messiah coming. But as we look at the Old Testament and we look at the prophetic messages that are set forth about this coming Messiah, we see that Jesus indeed fulfills all those things. You may remember us talking about some 300 plus prophecies in the Old Testament that can only be fulfilled by one man, and his name is Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. Born in a little village way back when in the first century. He fulfills all those things, a quick rundown of these prophecies, these promises that only he fulfills. We see that the seed of the woman would crush the work of Satan. We see that in Genesis 3. We see that there's a covenant with Abraham that through his faithfulness, as we've talked about, all the families of the earth will be blessed. We see that Christ would come from the tribe of Judah. We see that he will be a prophet greater than Moses in Deuteronomy. We see that he'd be a descendant of David. We see that in 2 Samuel and throughout the Chronicles and beyond. We see that this one would be forsaken by God and endure crucifixion. We see that in Psalm 22. We see the Messiah will be born of a virgin, Isaiah 7. We see that he'll be God with us in Isaiah 9. We see there'll be a suffering servant that'll take upon the sins upon humanity and be crushed for our iniquities. It'll also bring us healing. We see that in Isaiah 53. We see he'll be born in Bethlehem. We see that in Micah 5. We could go on and on and on. We could do all 300, but I know you'll get hungry. The Bible, over and over again, as we look at the Old Testament, shares promises of a Messiah that will come and points to a future event. It shares, I hesitate to say it this way, incomplete truth. It's perfect, but it's pointing to something else. It's pointing to this revelatory climax, this revelatory moment that'll happen in history. We see in verse 2 that that moment happens. We see in verse 2 that Jesus is the fulfillment of that. But in these last days, he, speaking of God, has spoken to us by his Son. All of these promises point to a future hope. And as shared here in Hebrews 1, verse 2, Jesus fulfills that hope. Now, it's interesting as we look there, it says that, but in these last days, God has spoken through Christ his Son. Things to note here is God has spoken. It's now a past tense event, as the writer of Hebrews would say, as obviously we would say from this vantage point in history. But he says it's the last days. You see, from a Hebrews understanding here, they were looking forward to the last days. The last days would be when the Messiah would show up. So for them, when Jesus shows up, indeed, the last days are inaugurated. The last days are initiated. And as Jesus said over and over again through his public ministry, what? The kingdom of heaven has come. The kingdom of the Lord is near. As we consider our vantage point here in history, in redemptive history, we ourselves are in the last days. We have been since Jesus was on the scene. And as we consider us being in the last days and consider that Jesus is the fulfillment of all hope, what keeps us from embracing the fulfillment of those promises? What keeps us from understanding or keeps us from embracing the truthfulness of Christ? For now we are in a time in need of salvation, for salvation has come and is here for all to embrace. As we consider Jesus to be indeed the fulfillment of all things, as we consider him to be the culmination that we now see in the last days, I think it's important for us to realize, and sometimes, I know we probably don't do it on purpose, but sometimes we say, we got Jesus now, we don't really need the Old Testament. That's not right. That's not the right thought at all. In fact, as we look at Scripture, we see in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, Jesus says this in the Sermon on the Mount, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." Jesus fulfills all the Old Testament, but it's so important for us as followers of Christ, as those seeking to be disciples of Jesus, that we understand the Old Testament to still be God's truth. It points to him. We don't throw out this, we don't throw out that because Jesus is on the scene now. No, we see it for what it is. As Paul noted, that the Old Testament was a law, the law was a tutor, was a teacher, helping us get ready to meet Christ. Think about this for a moment. Think about the Ten Commandments. Okay? So, that's the Ten Commandments. Jesus has come on the scene. Don't worry about that stuff. No. The Ten Commandments, God gives his people, not so they could go, okay, we got to do this, got to do this, got to do that, all these rules. No, the Ten Commandments, God gives his people to help them realize, you will not measure up. You need me. So as we look at the Old Testament, we see over and over again how great our need is for Christ. Preparing our heart, helping us to understand how much we need Jesus. As I pray before we kind of unpack this more, that there's come a time in your life where you've realized how greatly you need Jesus. You've realized that you will not measure up. As we talked in our series of the heroes of faith in Hebrews 11, we talked about all these great things these men did by faith and these women did by faith. They were all looking forward to the promise. They had not seen Jesus yet, as we said moments ago. Now as we look back to what Christ has accomplished, we too need to understand that to be a moment of victory for all of us. That all of us embrace that for what it is, that that's where our salvation rests, that's where our salvation lies. The fulfillment of truth that happens in Jesus. But just as we talk about Jesus being the fulfillment of that truth, we see that he is the truth that takes flesh. That truth comes and lives among us. He's the embodiment or the incarnation of that truth. We see this really beautifully outlined in this passage in seven different ways. We'll kind of group these together as we think through this. The first thing that we see right out of the gate, we get this to cooperate, there we go, that Jesus has authority over all as the heir of all things. Looking back in the passage as we understand Jesus to be the fulfillment of all things, we see back in verse 2, God whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. He upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. We'll see these seven things in these two short verses. But first, he has authority over all things as the heir of God himself. You know, he's the one that has authority over our lives. He's the one that has authority over history. You know, Jesus says throughout his ministry, as you see me, or as you believe in me, or as you love me, you love the Father. It's so important for us to understand that unique relationship that exists within the Trinitarian understanding of who God is. That God is indeed the Father. God is indeed the Son. God is indeed the Holy Spirit. And those work in conjunction together to accomplish the divine purposes. So as we see that Jesus is the heir of all things, that he has all authority, we know also that if we believe in the truthfulness of Christ, we believe that he is who he says he is, that we too become fellow heirs with him, that we too can be adopted as sons and daughters and have that same blessing of eternal life, to have that same blessing of being a part of God's family, being an heir of the divine things, an heir of that fellowship that he gives us. The other thing that we see here as we kind of unpack this passage, we see that indeed, as we've already alluded to within our reading, that he is the creator and sustainer of the world. Two passages to help us see this in Colossians 1, verses 16 and 17. For by him, talking about Christ, for by Christ all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Romans 11:36 says, for from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Christ himself, this fulfillment of truth that all of history pointed to, has come. He is the creator and he is the sustainer. He's the one that created all that we see. He created actually who we are. And as we see in these two passages, that it has a purpose. Not only is he our creator, but we are created for him. We exist and everything that happens in us for his glory. Again, let's go back to that focal statement that we said at the beginning before we started to unpack. All of history, past and present, finds its place, finds its purpose in Jesus Christ. Your story finds its purpose in Jesus Christ. We see here, again, look, it says, for from him and through him and to him are all things. The life of Lucas Butler is from him, is through him, and is to him in all things. Now put your name in there. Everything that you've experienced in your life, your journey, all of it has led up to the realization of who Christ is, or is leading up to the realization of who Christ is. The very fact that you draw breath is a gift from him. The family that you are blessed with is from him. The job that you have, the profession that you're in, the career that you had, or the retirement that you enjoy comes from him. All of that happens as a way of him being glorified within you and as a way to exhibit who he is in your life. You know, sometimes we're really quick to say, and I know this isn't the warm, fuzzy part of part of church, but we're really quick to say, you know, God has blessed me with all these things, but when the tough stuff shows up, now the devil just got all over me. Can I tell you this? Yes, the devil is at work. Yes, the devil wreaks havoc in our life, but the Lord also gives him the green light to do that. You remember Job? You're studying in Sunday school right now. God permits those things because he knows, yes, this is not something that I would do, but I'm going to use what happens in your life. If you'll just trust me, I'm going to use what happens in your life for your betterment, which is ultimately his glory. All of our histories begin and end with him. He's our creator and our sustainer. This is the wording says here in regard to creation and the maintaining, the sustaining. You know, as we look back at creation and we think about what we see in the book of Genesis and how God creates just by speaking, that same authoritative voice, that same powerful voice that brought the world into existence is the same one that speaks truth into our life, is the same one that ordains our days, is the same one that brings the rain and brings the sunshine into our life. All of it for his purposes. All of our stories, beginning and end, start with him. Again, we see that he is the heir of all things, has authority. He's a creator and sustainer of the world. And then we see indeed that Jesus is God among us. We see this noted here in this passage. Of course, yes, we know this. We go to church, but look at this. Verse 3, he is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. He's the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. So Christ himself is the light of God. He is the again, the fulfillment of all hope in the flesh. You know, many of us are familiar with John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Skip on down to 1:14, and the Word dwelt among us. The truth came in the flesh, and came in the flesh in such a way that he was an exact representation of God the Father. He was God. Now, at our house, and I know you guys have heard me talk about it before, and some of you even talk about it. You know, I've got three knucklehead kids, okay? Boys. And anytime someone meets us for the first time all together, or maybe just me with one of our kids or whatever, they're like, oh, he looks just like his daddy. And, you know, my boys are always, let's hope I grow out of that, okay? But it never fails. And they'll see them all three together. And it's like, wow, this is what they're going to look like. But, you know, as crazy as it is, and how no matter how much they kind of mirror my attributes, that is not an adequate illustration of how Jesus mirrors who God is, mirrors the Father. Because he, as we see here, an exact representation, an exact imprint. He is the same substance as God the Father. He is God among us. As we see Isaiah refer to him, and the Gospels refer to him as Emmanuel, God with us. And he does all that. He has authority over all things. He creates and sustains all things. And then he comes and dwells among us. The fulfillment of truth comes and takes flesh among us so that we may know him. Again, God graciously pursuing a rebellious people. He does all that so that we may know him, so that his glory can be seen in our life. And the last part that we see here as we kind of look at these things put together, many of these encompassing two of those seven observations, we see Christ is our priestly redeemer. Again, back in this, in verse 3, he upholds the universe by his word of his power. That talks about the sustaining aspect. After making a purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. This truth in the flesh that comes to redeem humanity or to pursue humanity offers a sacrifice, a purification for sin. As we'll see as we work through the book of Hebrews, how Jesus is this high priest, the eternal high priest that accomplishes a sacrifice once and for all. This one who was perfect. This one that was 100% God, that was 100% man, using some of that divine math. We see he comes and dies on the cross for our sins. Makes a sacrifice, purification of our sins. Our sin is what kept us away. Our sin is what made us rebellious. Our sin is why God had to move in history to show us who he was, how he had to build and build and build and build, and then boom, show us who Jesus was. Jesus comes on the scene and says, you know that mess? I'm going to take care of that mess for you. I'm going to take care of that mess at the cross. And he does. It makes a purification for our sin, makes a sacrifice, an atoning sacrifice for us. He becomes our substitute. If we place our faith and our hope and trust in Jesus Christ, understanding that he has done that on our behalf, he rescues us from that condemnation. And the beauty of this language here, as we just read a moment ago, he makes a purification of sin, and then what does he do? He sits down. We know he rose from the dead, the beauty of the resurrection, how it shows us we have new life. We know that he hung around on earth for a while and instructed his disciples, then he ascended, then he goes and he sits down. He sits, just as he said at the cross, it's finished. He's like, I've accomplished the task. It's complete. You don't need to add anything that I've done. No, no. I've done it all for you. You must simply believe. So he sits down at the right hand of the Father, sits down in that place of authority at his Father's right hand with the task completed, continuing to mediate for us, continuing to be our mediator, speaking on our behalf, standing in the gap for us rebellious people. So this morning, as we began our journey through the book of Hebrews, as we look at this Christology or this theology focusing in on Jesus and understand him to be the fulfillment of all truth, that he is all that we need. We don't need anything on top of Jesus. All we need is Jesus because he has all authority. He's our creator, our sustainer. He's our high priest. He's the one that goes to bat for us with the Father. Again, we come back to that statement that we began everything with. All history begins and ends with Jesus Christ. All of your story begins and ends with Jesus Christ. Whether you understand that or not, whether you're watching or you're sitting here and you're wrestling with it, well, I don't know if I buy into the whole Jesus thing. Can I tell you there will be a day when everyone will know that their story begins and ends with Jesus Christ. Passage of Scripture I know that you're familiar with to close out this morning comes from Philippians chapter 2, 9 and 10. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow. In heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I pray that you've already done that. I pray that there has come a time in your life where you realize that Jesus is the fulfillment of my hope, that he is all that I need, and you've trusted him with your life. And maybe it's you've realized that, and now you need to live it more. You need to live the fact that Christ has indeed fulfilled every need that you have, of being that example of hope to a community that needs to know who Jesus is. Or maybe you're here this morning and say, you know, I haven't done that. There hasn't been a time in my life where I've yielded to Jesus, where I've taken the knee, if you will, and allowed Christ to change my life, where I've asked for forgiveness. Today can be that day. But can I tell you? It needs to be today. Because we're not guaranteed tomorrow. But all of us, whether we believe in him in this life or not, will kneel before Christ because he is the fulfillment of all truth. All of history is dependent upon Jesus Christ. I pray that the day that we kneel before Christ, that'll be the very day we go into his presence for all eternity. But for those that don't kneel before Christ, those that don't give Christ their life on this side of eternity, why they still draw physical breath, when they kneel before Christ, that'll be indeed the last they see of him. Because they will spend the rest of eternity separated from God in torment. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the supremacy of Christ. We thank you for the fact that indeed he is the fulfillment of all things. Lord, I just pray for each one of us here, Lord, that indeed that we've realized that truth, that we've trusted Christ with our life, that we've said that we know that we cannot add enough, that we know that we're inadequate, we know that we're bankrupt, but we know that Jesus is our hope. So I pray for each person here, Lord, that they've trusted Christ. If they haven't, I pray that they come forward today. Lord, I'll be down front. I'd love to share with them how they can trust and believe in the fulfillment of all truth, how they can trust and believe in Jesus Christ. Lord, maybe they don't feel led to step out of the hour. Maybe they're too shy. Lord, maybe they just need to pull someone beside them that's standing there. Maybe someone's gone to church with them for years, and maybe they're finally yielding to Jesus. Maybe they just need to tell them, I need to get things right with the Lord. Lord, give them the opportunity to do that here in the next moment. Or maybe if there's someone watching online now or later or whatever, Father, just help them to find someone that can share with them about Christ. Or help them to reach out to us so we can share with them about Christ. Lord, as you've reminded me throughout this passage, and you've reminded us today, all of history begins and ends with Jesus. It all points to him. We're in the last days. He has come. The Messiah has come. The fulfillment of hope has come. And Lord, help us to live as people that have realized that hope. They don't get tangled up in the things of the world and try to matter and this, we got to accomplish this and that. But no, Lord, all we have to do is be faithful to you. To seek first your kingdom, and you'll take care of everything else. Lord, for some of us here this morning, just help us to repent of getting tangled up in stuff that doesn't matter. But help us to set our focus on the fulfillment of all things. And that's Jesus Christ himself. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Come and lead us now. Let's stand and sing.